Hello everyone and welcome to my talk about our paper presentation with the title Adaptive Elimination Sampling for Direct Volume Rendering. My name is Valentin Kraft, I'm working for the Fraunhofer MIVIS in Bremen, Germany, and in the following 20 minutes I will present our approach to you. Okay, let's start with a short introduction. So in the image on the right you can see a typical volume rendering. Volume rendering is typically used in addition to classical to-do slicing methodologies to view radiological image data in 3D. So volume rendering is a key technology for the visualization of these medical data, which is usually CT or MRI data. And as you can see, the image on the right isn't rendered with any lighting or shadowing, it's just an ambient light source. However, it has been proven that realistic lighting and shadowing improve the spatial understanding and also improve the ability to recognize anatomical structures significantly. You can also see this now in this updated picture where shadows and lighting is computed and simulated. So the image gets way more depth and it's also easier to recognize structures and measure distances visually. These realistic lighting and shadowing techniques are usually summarized under the umbrella term global illumination. So, global illumination is very complex already for surface rendering and it's a very well-known research field. However, it's even more complex for volume rendering because instead of discrete surfaces or pixels, we actually deal with whole volumes, so it's even more complicated to calculate global illumination for volume rendering. And furthermore, medical visualization also poses high demands for the exactness and also for real-time capabilities. That means, for example, that we want to have real-time clipping and real-time transfer function changes. And clipping is the interactive cutting of the dataset, and the transfer function is a function that maps the value of each voxel to a color and an opacity. So an example use case would be the VivaTop project. The VivaTop project is a research project with multiple clinical and industry partners. And the main focus of the project is the employing AR and VR technology for planning, teaching, and intervention support in abdominal surgery. And realistic volume rendering is a crucial element in this context, and also this paper therefore was released in the context of the project. And as we want to employ AR and VR technology, this imposes even higher requirements for resolution frame rates, because as you might know, for a convenient experience, you need at least 60 frames per second and a 2K resolution. So the challenge is how to compute realistic lighting for volume rendering. In real time, this itself is a very hard task already, but we also have to have clipping in real time and also the transfer function change in real time. And it also has to be suited for augmented and virtual reality. So this is really not a trivial task. So let's have a look at the related work and see what the current state of the art is in the research. So in general, global illumination is often approximated by ambient occlusion and image-based lighting. In the image on the right, you can see a simple scene rendered with only ambient occlusion. And as you can see, ambient occlusion is something like the self-shadowing between objects on each other. Usually, ambient occlusion is being computed by using ray tracing or local image processing. And common restrictions of ambient occlusion are pre-computation. This is very common because the computations are quite heavy. We have to pre-compute certain things. And also that clipping and or transfer function changes are not supported, or when they are supported, they are quite slow. So one way to accelerate ray traced effects is voxel cone tracing. The basic idea of voxel cone tracing is to replace rays with cones and use an hierarchical data representation. So it's, so to speak, an improvement for ray tracing. However, it was originally designed for surface rendering and only recently adapted to direct volume rendering, so but only for directional occlusion and shadows and without, for example, employing image-based lighting. Another popular GI method that was recently adapted to volume rendering as well as path tracing. Path tracing is a progressive rendering methodology and it converges to a physically plausible result. However, it is very slow and noisy. And although it was improved by temporal reprojection recently, it still suffers a lot from blurriness and noise. So our solution to this problem is to approximate global illumination by a combination of ambient occlusion and image-based lighting. And the basic idea here is twofold. So on the one hand, we want to reduce the number of elimination samples along the primary array, and we do this by subdividing it into segments. This also yields the name of the sampling methodology, so adaptive volumetric elimination sampling equals to ARVIS. And on the other hand, we also want to reduce the complexity of the elimination computation, and we do this by employing voxel cone tracing. Okay, so let's start with the first core idea, which is the adaptive volumetric elimination sampling. So over here you can see two pictures. The upper picture shows the kind of naive brute force approach, and the lower picture shows the our new ARVIS approach. So what these pictures show are rays that travel through the volume, so coming from the camera or the camera eye. When the ray is traveling through the volume, the naive approach would be to compute a lighting on each step along these rays, which is, as you can imagine, quite expensive. And we can also have a look at the volume rendering equation, which is down here. So the lighting computation is kind of hidden in this LSS term. And the LSS term is again involves the tracing of additional rays. So this means that for each lighting computation, additional rays have to be traced. So this is the kind of recursive element of the equation. So that means that the lighting computation is very expensive, and the ARVIS idea is now to overcome this by splitting the primary array into multiple segments. And this means that the lighting only is being computed once per segment. So the normal tracing of the array is done as usual, so the volume is sampled above the Nyquist frequency, but the lighting computation is way improved because we just compute the lighting once per segment. Okay, so this is now a graph of an exemplary ray traveling through the volume, and as the ray travels through the volume, it accumulates opacity. So this is one exemplary function for this. And as I already said, we want to compute the lighting only once per segment, and the aim is to compute the lighting close to solid structures, or also grouping sections with similar lighting. The underlying assumption is that the lighting doesn't change much between multiple samples, so yeah, we basically can group them. So the heuristic we decided on is to define segments based on accumulated opacity thresholds. These thresholds are, for example, here. So these are linear threshold values, and as you can see, this would split the array in four segments, and these segments are likely to start when also the opacity increases very much. So yeah, by this we compute the lighting close to solid structures if possible. Okay, then let's come to the second core idea, which was to reduce the lighting complexity itself. So as a reminder, the lighting model consists of a combination of ambient occlusion and image-based lighting. And we want to reduce the complexity of the ambient occlusion computation by voxel cone tracing. The core ideas of voxel cone tracing are, on the one hand, to combine multiple rays to cones, and to use a multi-resolution volume to quickly approximate this occlusion for one cone. The multi-resolution volume contains the whole scene at various resolution levels, and for an exemplary cone, a good approximation for the occlusion which is covered by this cone is to just add up the spheres which are contained in this cone, and the good approximation for the spheres are the boxes which are the individual voxels of the multi-resolution volume. And the advantage is over here that it's only minimal pre-computation required, because the creation of the multi-resolution volume comes down to just a downsampling, which can be implemented very efficiently, so it's real-time capable. And also the voxel extents doubles for each level in the multi-resolution volume, as you also see in the image. And this leads to an exponential growth of the step size, and sampling large neighborhoods with a few samples is therefore possible. Nice side effect is also that it's fully noise free. Okay, regarding the image based lighting, so when we want to compute the radians per cone, we have to sample the environment map. So usually you would sample the environment map at multiple samples, but we decided on employing pre-convoluted lighting, and this means that we pre-convolute the image, and by this we basically just have to take one sample per cone, which is also making the approach more efficient. To now give you some implementation details, so the original approach from Krasine proposed to use 5 cones, but we found that 6 cones are covering the hemisphere a lot better. Also, an aperture of approximately 67 degrees covers the full hemisphere without introducing gaps. So on the image on the right you can see some gaps. This is because the cones are just having an aperture of 60 degrees, but 67 degrees are reducing these gaps. The whole thing was implemented in a GDSL-based DVR raycaster in the MirrorSlab software, and we computed the lighting in the last quarter of each segment. Alright, let's come to results. So over here on the left you can see standard volume rendering without any lighting or shadowing being computed. In the middle left image you can see an AVAS rendering with 10 segments. In the middle right you can see a path tracing rendered image with 20 iterations. And on the rightmost image you can see the ground truth. For us we used a fully converged path tracer as the ground truth, but without temporal reprojection and just like the normal exposure renderer, which is well known. Okay, in order to see the differences better, let's magnify the two images. So here on the left is the AVAS rendering and here on the right is the path tracing. As you can see, the path tracing result is very blurry and also contains a lot of noise, while the AVAS rendering doesn't contain any noise and it is much sharper. This is the second dataset we used in our evaluation, which is the Chameleon dataset, which is publicly available. And it is a very high resolution dataset and was rendered in real time. So let's come to the results. Over here you can see the resulting frame rates for our method in frames per second. We tested with two datasets, the Torso dataset on the one hand and the Chameleon dataset on the other hand. The Chameleon dataset was available in two resolutions, and we tested with an image resolution of 2080 by 720 per eye on an Intel i7 and a GeForce RTX 2080 Ti. And we also tested both a static transfer function and an interactive transfer function, where we changed the function during the interaction with the rendering. And as you can see over here, we are very close to the standard DVR rendering, which is completely without lighting and shadowing being computed. So over here we are quite close to the original frame rate. In contrast to that, the path tracing result was very slow with 15 frames per second and thereby not real-time capable. And also for an interactive transfer function that is being changed during interaction, the AVAS rendering remains real-time capable, while the path tracing result is still quite slow with 14 frames per second. Also, the multi-resolution update wasn't implemented optimally yet, so the transfer function change is potentially also much faster. And also for the higher resolution dataset, the Chameleon with 1000 by 1000 by 1000, the AVAS rendering still remains quite high and close to the original standard DVR rendering frame rates. But in contrast to this, the path tracing is still very, very slow. So here you can see the Torso dataset rendered with different numbers of segments. And as one can see, already 5 segments seem to be a good approximation and are visually quite close to ground truth. Okay, so the results are looking fine, but are they really giving a good approximation for the ground truth? To answer this question, we tested the Torso dataset and rendered it with different numbers of segments and compared this against the ground truth. For this, we built a difference image and also computed the NCC, which is the normalized correlation coefficient. And as you can see, the NCC is very high. This means that we are very close to the ground truth. And also the images are multiplied with a factor of 10 so that you can recognize the differences at all. So this means that already for a low number of segments, for example 5 or 10, the approximation already is very, very good. And now I also want to present the interactive behavior of Arbus rendering by showing you our submitted video. And first we want to show just the standard volume rendering without any lighting or shadowing computation. Over here it is of course possible to clip through the volume. And this is now the Arbus rendering. It's running in real time while interactively computing lighting and shadowing. And it also supports interactive clipping. And it also supports an interactive transfer function change. As you can see, while we are changing the transfer function, the lighting and shadowing is updated and is producing the correct result. In contrast to this, you can see the path tracing rendering, which is very noisy during interaction and also takes multiple seconds to converge to a fully converged image. Okay, let's continue the discussion. So as I already said, in most other works, the transfer function changing in real time is not possible, and often also clipping is not considered. And there are some similar approaches to adaptive sampling or some similar segmenting ideas where rays are being segmented. But either the segments have fixed or equal length, or they apply to other rays such as secondary rays. And as I already said, also voxel cone tracing was applied to DVR, but it's slower and only directional occlusion from the camera and light sources supported. And also they don't employ image-based lighting. As I mentioned beforehand, path tracing was significantly improved by adaptive temporary prediction. This approach improved speed and reduced the noise of path tracing. And path tracing also offers more illumination effects, so for example indirect illumination or scattering. However, in the medical domain we mostly don't need this that much because we are mostly dealing with isolated objects where indirect illumination isn't really playing a big role or isn't really relevant. And still, path tracing is way more noisy and significantly slower than Arbus. And this makes it not very well suited, for example, especially for AR and VR settings. Okay, so to conclude, we presented a novel approach for the realistic lighting in DVR, which is based on our new Arbus algorithm, which decouples the lighting illumination from the volume sampling and on the adoption of voxel cone tracing. And this combined approach is both faster than path tracing, and it's also less noisy than path tracing. We gain instant clipping without the loss of performance. And we also have transfer function changes in real time. The approach is high performant and also HD and AR or VR ready. It's very easy to implement, for example, in a GLS Raycaster. And it also don't need almost no pre-computation. And in most cases, already 10 segments are sufficient to give a good approximation. For future work, we want to include additional lighting effects, such as, for example, scattering or indirect illumination, color bleeding, or directional point or area lights, and maybe other. And as I said, the segment border definition is a heuristic, but maybe we want to investigate also alternative segment border definition heuristics. So one idea would be to use the gradient for the segment borders. And this is now the point I want to give thanks to a couple of people. So first of all, Professor Dr. Weyer and his team at the Pius Hospital Oldenburg in the Department of General Visceral Surgery, which provided a lot of data sets and also provided a lot of help. This research project, VivaTop, is funded by the German Federal Ministry of Education and Research. And for more information, you can also visit the website vivatop.de. That was the talk. Thank you for your attention, and I'm now happy to answer some questions.